Hey guys, hope you're well. In this end track video, we're going to look at configuring devices on Mac. We're going to look at how to connect an external audio interface like this, how to use multiple audio devices and to locate audio devices in end track, to work out how to fix latency issues by adjusting buffering settings, feedback loop, that annoying feedback sound that sometimes sounds within DAWs, how to fix that as well, and live input monitoring using N-Track's echo button. Without further ado, let's get into it. Configuring your Mac's audio device with N-Track Studio applies to both your Mac's built-in audio device as well as to external audio interfaces. You can use your Mac's built-in audio device to record multi-track audio using the Mac built-in mic or a headset. However, you'll need an external audio interface if you want to improve the quality of your recordings, connect external microphones or instruments via an XLR or jack cable, or to record multiple channels at once. So let's run through the process of plugging in an external audio interface. We have an M Audio Fast Track that we're using for this example. The first thing that we're going to do is plug the USB cable into the back of the device. For other audio interfaces, for example, a Scarlett 6i6 shown here, you might also have to plug in a power supply, and there's the power switch, which is being switched on and off in this example too. And you can see that we're using the same USB connector. Let's switch back to the M audio interface, and we're plugging in a microphone to the input here via an XLR cable, as you can see. We'll also need an output for the sound, in this case, a pair of headphones. We can also enable the direct monitor button to monitor what we're recording in real time. And then we plug the external audio interface into the Mac via a USB cable. We're using a slightly newer MacBook Pro, so we've connected the USB to a USB-C adapter. If N-Track is open during this connection, it will automatically detect the new audio device and give you a yes or no choice of whether you'd like to use the new device. So if we press yes, we can see that N-Track has automatically assigned the M Audio Fast Track as an input device. And if we unplug the Fast Track, we can see that the input has switched back to the default internal audio interface. If we plug the Fast Track back into the computer, this time we're going to select no, we don't want N-Track to use it. And so we can see that the internal audio interface remains the input audio device. If we wanted to change the audio playback or recording device back to Fast Track, we can select it from settings and then audio devices. Upon clicking audio devices, we can see two columns, audio playback devices and audio recording devices, with a list of all of the available selection options. So we can see that built-in output and built-in microphone internal audio devices are currently selected. Let's go ahead and change those back to Fast Track, our M Audio external audio interface. From the audio devices menu, we can also select what to do when a USB audio device is detected. We can ask what to do, do nothing, or automatically select the device. Let's keep it as it was and press OK. Having selected Fast Track, we can see that it now appears as the recording and playback device on the audio track. It's possible to combine multiple audio interfaces. So if we go again to the settings and audio devices menu, and we can see that as well as the M Audio Fast Track external audio interface, we've plugged in the Scarlett 6i6 external audio interface too. We can see in the audio devices display that to use multiple devices, we need to create an aggregate device, which we can do by selecting the audio MIDI setup button. This can also be located from the Mac Finder under Applications, Utilities, and then Audio MIDI Setup. So to create an aggregate device, click on the plus button in the bottom left-hand screen and create aggregate device. We'll now see a list of all of our available internal and external audio devices, the number of input channels and output channels. So we'll start by selecting an aggregate device comprised of the Fast Track input and output channels and the Scarlett 6i6 external audio interface. If we select the help question mark, we can see that both external audio interfaces need the same sample rate to work efficiently. Let's check that they do under the sample rate tab. And we can see that both devices have a sample rate of 44.1 kHz. Let's also talk about drift correction. This is also known as resampling, and the help menu confirms that the selection boxes need to be enabled if no additional hardware is being used to connect the devices. It isn't in our case, the devices are connected separately to the Mac, so we'll make sure the drift correction boxes for the audio inputs are enabled. Now that our aggregate device is set up, we'll go ahead and close the audio MIDI setup window, and we can locate the new device in the audio devices menu. So we can see under audio playback devices and audio recording devices that we can now select the aggregate device. Let's do that. And if we go to select that on the audio track, we can now see we have an array of input options, and aggregate device is selected as our playback output. Let's navigate to buffering settings from the settings menu and hear an example of recording audio with dropout issues. By attempting to use an excessively small buffer size, we're using the hyper-low buffering setting. You can hear how these dropouts sound. We ideally want a low playback buffering size to achieve low latency, but without these dropouts. So we need to find that sweet spot between buffering size and audible latency lag. Here's medium buffering. We can hear that the dropouts have stopped, but there's a higher latency between seeing and hearing the lah input into N-track. So let's now go with the very low buffering option. It's a nice balance between minimal latency without any dropouts or glitches to the audio signal, so we'll stick with that. And if you have a fast machine, we recommend setting your playback buffering size low. We can adjust the sample frequency in N-track, and let's use the Apple AirPods to illustrate an example of this. So we've selected them as the recording and playback devices, and we'll see that we get an error setting the input audio driver sampling frequency. We'll press OK, and N-track automatically gives the option to try to find an audio format compatible with the selected audio device. If we press no to this pop-up box, we can locate the sampling frequency and change it manually within N-track. To adjust the sampling frequency of an N-track project, go to N-track, then preferences. We can choose from preset sampling frequency options or select custom to choose our own value. To locate the sampling frequency of an audio device, go to the audio devices menu and select audio MIDI setup. From the audio MIDI setup window, we've selected AirPods, and we can see that the frequency is 16 kilohertz or 16,000 hertz. So let's go back into N-track, go back to preferences, and we can manually set the value at 16,000. Once we've typed that in, we'll exit the preferences window, and we can see that we can select AirPods as an input device in mono or stereo and record as normal. Bit depth is the resolution with which N-track records and plays audio data. Higher resolution translates into higher quality. And as you can see, the default bit depth in N-track is 32 float. We can also select the recording bit depth from recording file format. The default value is equal sound card format. We also have three other options to choose from in the drop-down menu: 16, 24, and 32-bit float. 16-bit is the format used for audio CDs and gives excellent audio quality, while 24-bit is better still and allows even more headroom when recording. For those of you that don't know, headroom is the space between the highest peak on a track and 0 dB. This headroom space helps you prevent your mix from sounding clipped or distorted. 32-bit float is useful as an intermediate format, for example, in order to bounce tracks, and gives even more freedom in the level so that it doesn't risk clipping or distortion. You need to select the bit format that the audio device is compatible with. So, if an audio device supports both 16 and 24 bits, then choose 24-bit. Something to bear in mind as well is that the higher the bit rate, the higher the recorded file size. You can also see 32 float is the default for the playback format. When recording live audio using internal or external audio devices, we can enable the echo button to echo the signal that is being inputted into N-track through headphones or speakers. We can hear an example of that just now. This is useful to hear how your input is sounding in real time and check for unwanted dropouts or distortions. Let's unselect the echo button and walk through an example of audio device built-in input monitoring available with external audio devices. So let's adjust the mic gain. The guitar gain we don't need because we're using a microphone only, and the output to our liking. And if we tilt the M Audio device, we can see a button called Direct Monitoring. If we enable that, this will allow a real-time audio input to be heard in N-track like this.
One, two, three.
Audio device input monitoring allows monitoring with zero latency, while N-track's live echo monitoring may add a small amount of latency depending on your buffering settings, but has the advantage to allow hearing the input sound processed with the track's effects. So it may be useful, for example, if you're playing an electric guitar, using a guitar plugin such as N-track's built-in guitar amp. Let's also hear an example of something to be careful of if we enable N-track's echo button.
One, two, three.
So you get an unwanted chorus-like effect if monitoring on the external audio interface and N-track's echo button are both enabled at the same time. Let's also talk about feedback loops. You can be recording a vocal or an external instrument and hear unwanted feedback noise.
One, two, three.
Let's hear it again.
la, la, 1, 2, 3.
You're likely to hear feedback when your microphone picks up an audio signal input, which is outputted through your speakers. And this speaker output signal gets re-inputted through N-Track's echo button, which is active when highlighted yellow, like now. Turning it off cuts the speaker output being immediately inputted back into N-Track and thus kills the feedback loop, stopping the unwanted noise. Let's hear that in action.
La, la, 1, 2, 3.
It can also be possible to kill a feedback loop with the echo button enabled by using headphones instead of the audio output playing through speakers. This is because sound output is contained by the headphones rather than the output signal being played openly out of speakers, and that speaker output being picked up by a microphone again. So we've plugged in a pair of headphones. Let's enable the echo button and hear an example, hopefully without any feedback noise.
La, la, 1, 2, 3.
Okay guys, thanks for watching. I hope you learned something from this video. If you've got any more questions, leave a comment below. Subscribe, like, and all that good stuff. And we'll see you on the next one. Cheers.